Welcome everybody, this is Vyadi Rao. As you folks know, we have started interviewing some of the best traders in the world as part of our series called Interview with Stock Market Legends. And this video is part 2 of the interview with Steve Burns, arguably one of the most popular traders in the United States. So if you've not watched part 1, I strongly recommend you to start there because this video will make much more sense after watching that video. So the link is given in the description below. So with that said, let's listen into Steve to know how he trades, what indicator he uses, what is his strategy, what he thinks about intraday trading, and much, much more. So that's interesting actually, Steve, because options are so popular, not just in US, but also in India. And one of the reasons they are very popular is because they are so cheap and they are such a leveraged product. It's very interesting to know that you do not really prefer trading in options and you want to stick with old-fashioned, the cash segment. Is there a reason why?
Yeah. I don't need that. I traded options for a long time because I like the leverage. You know, it's easier to trade. I don't need it like I used to need the leverage. And you have to overcome the volatility crash at times. You also have to overcome the time decay. And it does add extra dimension. I mean, options are best used for leverage and for trading volatility. And I don't need a lot of that in this day and time. But it is a great instrument if you need leverage and you understand what you're doing. There's lots of different ways to make money with options, but just not my preferred way to trade.
So what do you trade, Steve? Do you focus on the index or do you focus on individual stocks?
I primarily prefer to trade stock indexes, but they have not had the good sustained trends a lot recently, so I've turned more to stocks, individual stocks a lot of the time. But I do love trading leverage ETFs to amplify the alpha that you get from indexes. Indexes are one of the most well-behaved, consistent movers that have a bullish bias. So I do prefer indexes to trade with size when possible. But I trade primarily individual stocks along with indexes.
So if you have to give a breakdown, what would you say would be the percentage of trades that you take on index versus stocks?
So probably about 50-50, depending on what's trending. You know, times the indexes are just going sideways, I'll be primarily focused on individual stocks. And when stocks become highly volatile, then I'll focus on indexes for more smooth trading. It really all just depends on the price action going on currently. If I had my way, I would love to just trade leveraged index ETFs if they were always in a trend.
Any favorite index of yours?
The S&P 500 is just a steady, nice, consistent mover. It has some of the best, historically it reacts the best around moving averages and overbought, oversold indicators and crossover signals. So really like the S&P 500 and all the derivatives from it, like the SPY ETF and the double leverage SSO. And also their options are really liquid. So S&P 500 definitely my favorite.
And for stocks, what kind of stocks do you focus on? Are they the big ones like Apple, Netflix, or the mid caps, small caps, and even penny stocks, which are very popular in the US market?
Yeah, I focus almost primarily on the big cap winners. You know, only generally 80% of all market returns come from 20% of the best stocks. So I tend to focus on the stocks with the most alpha, and like the Amazons, the Apples, the Facebooks, the Googles. That's really what I focus on for growth. If I trade micro caps or small caps, I generally trade the indexes, the Russell 2000 or the IWC ETF. I focus on indexes when I get into smaller stocks for the most part. But big cap stocks is what I mainly trade.
You did not get attracted towards the penny stock, which have been very infamous for trapping a lot of investors and traders with the allure of giving, 10 times, 15 times returns?
So much of penny stocks is so dangerous. You know, anything traded on the pink sheets and off the major exchanges aren't regulated. So there's a lot of penny stocks that are just flat out scams. They can also have liquidity issues where you can't even get in and out quickly. Just so many dangers of penny stocks. I just do not trade them. I don't trade things on the pink sheets either. I focus on the only regulated exchanges and real companies.
Makes sense. Makes perfect sense. Just wanted to make sure. and you said in the beginning that you are a trend trader. And I'm sure trend has definitely worked out in the US market for past decade and in fact, past 20 years. But at the same time, there is a group of traders who believe more on this mean reversion kind of trades, where they look for the points, the pivots where the market turns. And so they prefer to take contra trades. When the markets are going up, they prefer to short. And when the markets are going down, they prefer to take long trades. So you don't follow the mean reversion kind of trades?
The only mean reversion trades I will do is a long side trade, like an extremely oversold reading on a gross Achard index, you know, like a less than 30 RSI. You know, I might step in and buy a deep dip on the long side for a reversion back to the mean or back to a short-term moving average. That is about the only one I do. And I do that much, much less than I do with just simple moving average crossover trend trades. But I will do a long side reversion to the mean. Oversold a dip buy at times.
So the U.S. market has been in a bull run for quite some time, and I'm sure the kind of economy it is, it's all, you know, it's going to grow. But what if the market goes into some sort of a range, like a lot of markets in Europe and in Asia as well, Japan, for example. So when there is no clear trend to trade, right? I mean, you may have some small trends here and there, but no broader market trends. How do you think your trading style will do? Or will you make some changes to your trading style in case the US market goes into, let's say, a consolidation or a range bound for the, let's say, next 5 years or so?
Oh, yeah, that's what I've been through that before for 2015 and 2011. 2010, there, I've been through that before, and that's when I do take some deep dip buys and reversions of the mean trade where it's in a long-term range. I will buy the dips to the 30 RSI range and look for a bounce back up. That's generally the only way I can trade those kind of markets. They're not as profitable as strong trending markets are. I'll also have a large watch list of stocks and indexes, so I will have a large watch list to look for signals in, and I also will use my diversification of signals with the dip buys and reversions in those kind of markets. So you have to have a diversified watch list and a diversified signals to give you opportunities to make money in all types of markets.
Speaking of signals, which technical indicators do you use while spotting opportunities?
Yeah, my primary signals for trend trading is moving averages. The 5-day EMA, 10-day EMA, 20-day EMA, 50-day EMA are my primary signals. I also have a 200-day simple moving average as a longer-term trend filter. And I also use the RSI 14 as a daily oversold overbought indicator. So I just have oversold indicators and moving averages. Those are the primary things I use on my chart.
And do you also look at the global markets, or you are just primarily focused on the U.S. market?
I mean, I look at them. I don't have really trade them or have any signals off of them. I look at them more for interest to see what's going on, but not for trading.
So, Steve, now let's talk about your process, right? So how do you spot trading opportunities? Maybe a good recent example will help to visualize or maybe understand exactly, you know, how do you spot trading opportunities and initiate a trade?
Yeah, I look for a lot of times moving average crossovers. You know, if a 5-day moving average crossover happens five and crosses and closes above the 20-day EMA, then that is a trade I will take. If that specific stock or index back tests well, I will take that trade. So think of a recent example. The Alibaba, it had a 520-day EMA crossover back July 2nd. I went long on that crossover and held it for several trading days. And then I exited as it gapped up on strength and got close to the 70 RSI intraday. I exited for a 6.44% gain. So if you look back at the July Alibaba chart, it was a 520 crossover signal on the chart, a long, and held it till it became overbought near the 70 RSI. That's where I exited. So, you know, a lot of simple trading using momentum and back tests and signals, and then exiting as risk reward ratio diminishes as a chart becomes overbought.
So when you see an opportunity like this, do you also cross-check the broader market trend like S&P 500 to make sure that the direction of your trade is in line with the direction of the broader market, or you just want to focus on the individual stock?
No, I have a lot of the stocks I trade, they all individually go through their own accumulation and distribution cycles. And what I've done is already back-tested a large watch list of stocks, and I know historically when crossovers happen, how big the wins generally are. So I look to take those entry signals based on that specific chart with that specific signal, as all stocks tend to be different. Some have smoother trends with a 520 crossover, then they have strong momentum, and then they go back sideways. Others have a longer-term trend with a 1050 crossover, and they stay in trends for a longer period of time. So, you know, it's all based on quantified signals that have an edge. I know what the positive expectancy rate is. I know what the win rate is. I know what the average win, average loss is. I know when charts tend to go sideways based on readings. And everything I do is quantified. There's no opinions or predictions involved in it.
That's actually interesting, because I wanted to ask you this, that over a period of time, let's say the past 5 years, what percentage of your trades ended up as winners versus losers?
Yeah, my win rate's between 55% and 60%. Now, I will have big winning streaks where I'll have 10, 15 in a row winners, which is whenever the market's just going straight up. And then I could have losing streaks of 5 or 10 in a row that are losers. But what people need to really think about listening for your listeners and viewers is you have to look at the positive expectancy model. If you have a 50-50 win rate, you have to see how much do you need to win or lose to be profitable. That's where the magic happens, is a risk reward ratio. If you flip a coin and if it's heads, you win $3, and if it's tails, you lose $1, you know, that's a positive expectancy model where you can flip the coin and make money over the long term, because you're making more when you're right than losing when you're wrong. That's where profitable trading comes from.
Right, exactly right. And so speaking of that, if you have to give a rough idea of the size of average profit with respect to the size of an average loss, what would that ratio be?
My risk reward ratio of the long term is around one risk for three reward, 1-3 risk to reward ratio. Sometimes it gets as low as 1-2.5 risk to reward ratio, but I try to get about a 1-3. If I'm going to risk 1% of my trading capital, I want to make 3% of my trading capital. If I'm going to risk $100, I want to make at least $300. I mean, sometimes it'll work out great where I'll, you know, have a reward of a 6 versus a 1 risk, and that helps bring up the risk reward. And generally, though, my maximum loss size is the 1 or even 0.5% of my total trading capital. I try to keep my losses as small as possible, so my rewards have a more meaning. You know, you can, whatever trading system you have to keep your losses small. You know, the profitability only comes from having big wins, small losses. You know, if you have a high winning percent and they're both equal, you can still make money with a high winning percent, even if your losses and wins are equal. But if you have big losses, you generally will not be profitable regardless of your system or strategy. And if you have a losing streak with big losses, you eventually will blow up.
So in terms of the losses, what is your typical stop loss like? Is it like 2%, 3%? Do you see stop losses like that, or do you have like absolute amount that you have in mind?
Yeah, it's really more, it's not really a percentage as much as like I'll buy a 520 crossover and I'll stay long unless the 5 crosses back under the 20 a lot of times. So if I'm wrong, I might lose 3% on the trade, but if it goes into a trend, I can make 9% to the upside. But it's not really a set percentage as much as a signal. You know, if I bought a 520 crossover and then the price gapped down under the 5 and the 20, you know, and it was a clear reversal, even if the 5 didn't cross on the 20, I might just go ahead and cut the loss there. My number one priority is keeping losses small. So I try to, if I have a stock, a 10% position size, you know, and you lose 10% on a stock, the stock goes down 10%, 10% position size, your loss would only be 1% of your total trading cap. That's my maximum worst case scenario, is I lose 1%. On a single trade. But if it goes up 20% on the stock, you've made 2% on your entire trading capital. So that's really how I quantify it.
Got it. So when you size your position, Steve, so just give us some idea about how do you enter. So in the case of Alibaba, which you mentioned, you got the signal. And after getting the signal, do you just enter with the total capital that you have in mind for the trade, or do you enter with a small amount and then you scale up as you go along?
Yeah, you know, with the size of my capital, I just do a 10% in, 10% out. I mean, there were times where in the past where I tried to get a really large trade of the indexes, you know, coming out of a bear market, if the S&P 500 SPY ETF broke over the 200-day moving average, I might, you know, take a 10% position size, and then if it kept going up and then it had a 1050 crossover later and it confirmed it was going up, then I might take another 10% in. And I used to scale in if I was really going with my larger capital base in my long-term account. But for my trading account now, I just do 10% in, 10% out. But I would scale it, especially coming out of a long bear market or something. And I was going to try to really build up a large position in the indexes. That's the only time I would try to scale in.
And has it ever happened to you that you took a trade and there was an instant regret that that was a bad idea?
Maybe 10, 15 years ago in that time frame. Yeah, I've gotten so mechanical now, you know, it's just binary. It's either a crossover or it's not. I'm either going to take it or I'm not. I usually make all my decisions before the market opens, so I have no regrets when the market's trading. There's no second guesses. I know exactly what my trading system is, my watch list is, my signals are, and I know what my filters are for making decisions. But that has taken a long time to get to that place. You know, when you get to the place where you're just running your trading like a business and remove a lot of the emotions and second guessing, it helps get rid of all the stress. And that does happen over the long term when you have complete confidence in yourself and your system.
So here, a lot of people would be wondering that your system is so simple, at least it sounds simple. How is it not possible for anybody else out there who is listening to you to just, you know, replicate this, look for a crossover, and then, you know, make money? Why is it not so easy?
Because it doesn't always work. It doesn't always win. You know, like we talked about, the positive expectancy model, you will have losing streaks. You will have no signals when there's no crossovers. And you have to have the confidence and faith to understand what you're doing. You have to understand the drawdowns. You know, it's not a holy grail where you just buy crossovers and make money. You know, you have to understand, you buy a crossover, you might make 10% on the stock, or you might lose 3% on the stock. And you have to go through the equity curve. You know, the reality of trading is a lot different than the theory of trading. And it's why it's so hard for people to even buy it, to use someone else's system, because they don't have the real time and real money when things start going haywire. It's a lot different than like shooting at a target and hitting the bullseye. It's a lot different than having somebody shooting at you when you're trying to hit the target. So, but people can use the principle somebody else uses to build their own system that fits their time frame, fits their risk tolerance, gives them the possibility to make their return goals, but it has to be what they're comfortable with and they understand and it fits them. So, you know, it's just, if you're not really psychologically fit to use somebody else's system, you know, it's a lot more complicated than that when, you know, there's ups and downs to everything and everybody. So you have to find what fits you.
I totally agree. And this is also my same experience I had. You know, I tried with something which was working for somebody else. And when I tried on my own, it was not working. So then I realized that, you know, it's time for me to come up with my own system. So Steve, the next thing I wanted to ask was, like, what software do you use for charting, scanning, or alerting, you know, whichever you need to figure out these entry signals and exit signals? What software do you use?
The best one that has everything in it is trendspider.com, and they are working on adding Indian ticker symbols to their platform and their charting and backtesting software right now. So trendspider.com is my go-to place for charts and backtesting. Other ones I use, the more historical testing, stockcharts.com. You can set the dates for anything you want. And ETF Replay is another one you can backtest U.S. ETFs on. But Trendspider has everything and has it in depth, much more than the others, but they all have their place in what I do.
Okay. And I know that you are very active on social media. You have a very active following on Twitter, almost 3,300,000, right? So do you also look for some sort of a sentiment, social sentiment about individual stocks, or do you try to stay away from that noise and just focus more on your own signals?
Yeah, social media is just for entertainment and information only. I don't really have any kind of sentiment, but I do learn things from other people on social media, and I can learn about new ticker symbols and new ETFs to go back test, but not sentiment specifically.
So, Steve, now I want to ask your opinion about a few things which are very interesting, especially in the Indian market. And the first of that is intraday trading. So what is your opinion about intraday trading? Because what is happening in India is that a lot of people are attracted towards intraday trading because brokers here, they're giving a lot of leverage. So there is some sort of a promise that, you know, if you use intraday trading, if you do day trading, you can make much more, much higher return as compared to, let's say, a swing trade or a positional trade. So a lot of people, especially beginners, are getting attracted towards this, and more so people who have very low capital. So what is your opinion about intraday trading? Do you think it's profitable?
Yeah, I did day trading for about a year. And one thing I learned about that a year is I didn't like doing it. It was a huge suck on time. I have no desire to spend 6, 7, 8 hours a day in front of a computer screen, a terrible quality of life. You know, you might as well have a job if you're going to be a day trader, because you're taking on the risk and you're risking your capital both, and you're giving away all your time. So it wasn't a good fit for me. All my profits and money over the long term been made in long-term trends where I was holding something going up day after day for long periods of time, not sitting in front of a screen all day. I mean, like I said, it has a place. If some people love day trading, if they enjoy it, they get energized by it. You know, they have quantified systems with an edge that they trade day trading. Most of the day traders I know that are successful only trade for the opening hour for the most part, and move on with the rest of their day and make money when the liquidity of the moves happen. But it's like anything else, you know, anything can work if you have a quantified system for doing it over and over again and making money. Definitely not my thing, and definitely not a great thing to do if you're under leveraged with capital and you're trying to use someone else's leverage to get up your buying power. Generally, leverage just causes blow-ups, especially for a new trader should be learning, not trading with leverage day trading. So not my thing. There's people that have done it very successfully, not something I even want to try to do.
So it's a very important advice. I'm sure my listeners will take that into their consideration. What about algo trading, Steve? What do you think about that? Do you think people who are doing algo trading, they have some sort of an edge over those discretionary traders who believe on their own judgment?
Yeah, there's strengths and weaknesses to algorithmic trading. I mean, if you're letting, like Renaissance Technologies had some of the greatest records ever created for traders doing algo trading at the highest levels with the fastest computers. You know, if you use it just to say call a mechanical trading system, an algorithm, you know, that can be very easy. Like a business, you have an algorithm, you have a mechanical trading system, you just follow your signals and you try to take all the emotions out and stress out and just do it. But it's amazing how hard people will find that to do when they feel like they know better than the algo and try to override it. So if you use an algorithm like a mechanical trading system with an edge, if you can have the discipline to follow it no matter what, it can be very useful. But if it still stresses you out with drawdowns, it's not going to help you much. Discretionary traders, a lot of their edge comes from just creating good risk reward ratios and having great trade management. The skill of a discretionary trader is really just taking good quantified setups and then managing it so it's either a small loss or a big win. That's really what the edge a discretionary trader has over an algo.
So have you ever tried algo trading, or like, is there any inclination for you to give it a shot in some time in future?
I love backtesting mechanical systems, but I still manually enter my trades at the close every day and manually position size and even manually do my stop losses if they have emergency stop loss or end of day stop loss. So, you know, I do not want to do algorithmic trading, but I do backtest mechanical systems to give myself a framework to work within for entries and exits and managing my trades and position sizing. But I do prefer having signals that I manage.
So since you started back in 2002, Steve, how do you think the trading scene has changed? Like, what do you see as something which has changed drastically from the time when you started and we are sitting in 2020? How have things shaped?
Commission costs coming down to zero now for most people. They don't have anything holding them back from active trading. So you see a lot more activity, a lot more volume, and people just getting in and out of things much faster than they used to. Even before there were discount brokers back in the 90s, things moved so much slower because, you know, it cost you money to get in and out over and over again. It was even more expensive going back into the 80s and 70s. But with just cheap trading and technology, and people all have their apps on their phones in their pocket to trade, and Robinhood and zero trading, the barrier to entry has never been lower to trade. So never been more people in it, and they've never had less of a problem with getting in and out of things quickly with no commission costs. So I think speed continues to amplify with the moves. What used to take a month can now happen in a few days.
Definitely, that's the case. And definitely in the Indian market, I can tell you for sure that's changing very drastically.
Now, in terms of the return on capital, let's say someone who is starting in the US stock market, what do you think will be a reasonable expectation that if I'm bringing, let's say, X amount of capital, I would make Y% of return at the end of the year?
And if you're new, you're probably not going to make anything actively trading. But if you have a quantified system with an edge, I mean, a good quantified system, I mean, if you're making 15 to 20% a year return on your capital consistently, you're in the top of the traders in the world. I mean, you look at the most professional mutual fund managers, hedge fund managers, even the Warren Buffetts, the George Soros, the Paul Tudor Jones, you know, 15 to 20% is a great annual rate of return. And most people cannot wrap their brain around that. That is great, and you compound that money, it will grow exponentially very quickly. And that's a barrier that most people can never get past. They think they're going to make 15-20% a month, and you could, but the odds of trading that big, you eventually will go to zero, or your drawdown of 50%, it'll take you 100% to get back to even. And that's a bridge most people can't comprehend. Whatever you have to make it worth your trouble for your active trading, whatever that is to you. But 15-20%, once you do have a profitable system in place, that is a really good return. You could be hired by a prop firm if you could do that consistently.
Yeah, 15-20%, that's really an amazing return if you are consistent.
Yes.
Right. If you can stay consistent, I think that's the operating word here. If you can stay consistent, then this is huge.
Yeah, I mean, just taking 20% returns for any kind of size of capital for a 7-8 year period a few times can change your life.
Yeah. And someone who is starting out without a lot of guidance, how long do you think it's going to take for them to learn trading?
Well, I think a normal person on a right trajectory and path and studying it could become profitable within 18 months if they, you know, don't become stubborn and go down the wrong path. If they find somebody who is profitable and they learn the principles from them to create their own system that fits them, then it could be an 18-month process or less. But it's just how quickly can you get past your ego and predictions and opinions and desire to risk too much. There's a lot of things to overcome and learn about yourself when you start trading real money.
So we have a lot of people who are entering into the market and they are new, not a lot of guidance in the Indian market. So for someone who is starting out fresh, right, and who's listening to you, what advice would you like to give them when they are just starting out?
Yeah, from the very beginning, let me tell you what your goal is. Your goal is to find a quantified profitable trading system with an edge that fits your own risk tolerance and return goals that you can trade with discipline over the long term. That's what you're looking for. Anything outside of that is just noise and confusion and details.
And in terms of trading psychology, I know that is something which is very hard to master, but a lot of people lose a lot of money because they don't really understand how our human psychology works in the market context. Do you have any advice regarding how do you control your emotions?
Yeah, you have to develop faith in yourself to execute your system with discipline, and you believe in yourself to do it. And you also have to have faith in the system that you're executing so you can get through the drawdowns and losing streaks and keep going. You know, you can turn down the volume and stress on your trading if you lower your position size. You have to trade at a position size in your trading that does not involve your ego or your fear or your greed or your uncertainty. You have to get comfortable like you're running a business, not like you're gambling in a casino.
And a lot of people, they want to make trading as a full-time career, Steve. So what do you think? Is it a good idea or they should stick to their regular jobs and make this more of a part-time income?
Yeah, just like with professional sports, for the vast majority of people, it's better to trade for capital gains with a system than it is to try to trade full time. To trade full time, it becomes a very complex thing because you have to have enough capital and you have to have a good enough system. And you have enough consistency and low enough bills and debt where your returns can pay for your living expenses. That's very rare. Most people that make a living trading are trading with the leverage of prop firms after spending years developing their skills. A lot of them only have access to capital when they absolutely need it for living expenses, even the prop firms. And a lot of people make money managing capital and trading it, not trading their own capital. Most traders are not trading to pay their light bill. They're trading for long-term capital gains on money that's discretionary. So it's there are full-time traders who trade for a living with large capital, but that is a rare thing to do. And the most dangerous thing, think you're going to trade for a living with a small amount of capital. I mean, you need realistically in the US, you need multiple six figures of capital and very, very low, if almost no debt or bills to be able to pull it off consistently with no stress.
Definitely. I completely agree with that. And that's one of the advice that even I give to people who are very ambitious, that, you know, at least be consistent in what you're making as a part-time income. And then once you see some consistency and once you have enough capital, maybe that's the time you even consider looking at it as a career. As far as your weakness is concerned, Steve, is there something which you struggled very hard to overcome in your trading career?
Yeah, my biggest weakness was always being too aggressive, feeling like someone was going to go somewhere and I had a signal and I would just go too big. It took me years and years and years to get that completely out of my system, which big losses will cure you of that eventually, where, you know, you can trade whatever, just don't trade it so big that it hurts you if you're wrong. And took me about a decade to beat that into my skull, but it was definitely something that I quit being so aggressive, which being aggressive when I was young and I was trying to grow my capital, you know, sometimes it worked out phenomenally for me. I've had some phenomenal trades being very aggressive when I was very young, but as your capital gets bigger and bigger, it can hurt more to lose larger amounts of capital on drawdown. So how much I hate losses and hate drawdown, that's really helped me to just trade smaller position size and be consistent about it.
And in terms of books, Steve, I know that you yourself are a writer. You have written many books. I have read a couple of your books, which I was really impressed with. Very simple, elegant way of expressing your thoughts. So I will ask a couple of questions here. So one is, which books were you influenced with when you started your trading journey? And second, which of your books are you most proud of and you would like my audience to read?
The books that influenced me the most were Trend Following and Market Wizards, because they were studies of the world's greatest traders. And they talked to them, interviewed them, and showed some Trend Following showed the quantified data for some of their returns and drawdowns and how their equity curves worked and the principles of Trend Following. Market Wizards, you know, even Paul Tudor Jones, Etsy Coder were interviewed in them, really gives you a glimpse, not of something silly or somebody trying to sell something or all the silliness that goes on in social media and online. It was really the best traders, some of the best traders in the world were interviewed for those books. So that's where you go to the source of the wisdom. So those both helped me. Alexander Elder's book, Come to My Trading Room and Trading for a Living, they really helped me understand the three dynamics of trading psychology, risk management, and system. Those three things, you have to have all three things as a trader or you're not going to make it. So those were some of the most influential books I ever read. I think the best books for new traders to read of mine that I'm most proud of is New Trader, Rich Trader and New Trader, Rich Trader 2, because it shows the difference between new traders and rich traders. It also shows the difference. The second book shows what good trades versus bad trades are. I think it's a really good place to start to really understand the basic principles of profitable trading.
Definitely. Steve, that is something I'm sure my audience is going to appreciate and read. So Steve, I really want to thank you for your time, your patience in answering all these questions. And I'm sure my audience is going to appreciate the candor and the wisdom that you have shared with us. And I hope that at some point in future, we will come back and kind of revisit the new scene at the time. But as of now, I really want to thank you for your time. Thank you for your patience. Thank you for sharing all the wisdom that you have shared with us.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me. And I always love to hear from my Indian trading friends. And you're doing a great job on your YouTube channel. And thanks for having me.
Thank you very much, Steve.
Thank you.